Quarterfinals, Champions League, a bit of a preview, a bit of a prediction here from Adrian from Rabona TV. Last time I did just okay with my predictions, 5 from 8, though the United and Ajax ones where I pivoted towards the wrong answer at the last second still haunt me. But anyways, it's time to make amends, so no further introductions needed, let's go. So, Manchester United were able to navigate PSG, a PSG that was missing two of their star players in Cavani and Neymar, but if you're going to say that, then you should also look at who United were missing during this tie, especially in the second leg, where you would be forgiven for thinking that was their reserve team playing. That being said, while United's youngsters deserve credit and United defended fairly well in the second leg and the achievement of turning around two away goals is nothing to sneeze at, I think we can all agree, well, besides the United fans who are going to tell me otherwise, that they were quite fortunate. Buffon makes a once-in-a-sparkling-career mistake, Carrier gifts Lukaku possession in the final third, he did well with the finish though, and then a shot that was destined for the stands drew a handball out of Kimpembe, and United squeaked through. If you look at how they've been playing for Solskjaer, I think their results have masked some pretty brutal performances. Take nothing away from their early matches under Solskjaer, where they had that new manager bounce and Pogba was on fire, but the bounce is over. Solskjaer is the permanent manager now, and Pogba has cooled off. How will the team react, and perhaps more importantly, how will Solskjaer perform now that there's the added pressure of being the permanent manager? Before, he could afford some errors, he could afford some liberties tactically because he had nothing to lose as the temporary manager, but now he does have something to lose, his own job. Maybe not this season, definitely not this season, but the pressure is there now. And then there's Barcelona, who have been bounced from this competition in the quarterfinals in the last 3 seasons in a row. Atletico did it, then Juve and Roma. They're the teams who did the damage. This season, however, Lionel Messi seems to be on a mission. And sure, he isn't putting up the numbers that he did back in the 2011-12 season, for example, but there seems to be a steely determination amongst himself and his teammates in this competition, as if they've finally grown tired of seeing Real Madrid win title after title, and they want to bring it back to Barcelona, which, if they do, would bring Messi level with Ronaldo on 5 Champions League titles. 2006, 2009, 2011, and 2015 are the 4 titles that he's won so far. So Messi's obviously on fire this season, having scored 8 and assisted 3 in the UCL, while he leads La Liga in both goals and assists. And the cast around him is mostly in good form, if not for a little streaky. That said, they haven't lost since January. In fact, they've only lost 4 times this season across all competitions, 2 of which were in their Copa del Rey first leg, only to go on and win the tie in the second leg. And I look at the options Barcelona have in the attack, and I compare their midfields and the respective form and performances of the two teams, and I just can't see any other result but Barcelona going through. I mean, look at what Jota did against United's defense with a little bit of space. In the FA Cup, I mean, as I know they play today, so that could be a little bit confusing. And now think of what Messi could do to that defense. It will take absolute heroics of a level that I'm not sure this United side are capable of in order to get by Barcelona. So I'm going to say Barca through 4-2. Ooh, sorry for that rhyme. Okay, moving on to the all-English grudge match, City versus Tottenham. Now, City were looking good in last year's competition before they met their maker, Liverpool, which, to be fair, Liverpool were the finalists, and if it wasn't for Loris Karius, we may have been speaking about them this season as Champions League champions. Pep obviously wants to win everything, just as the City board would like to win everything, but I think that if you gave them a choice, and they absolutely had to choose between the Champions League and another league title, then City would elect to focus on the Champions League. I'm sure that's what these newly minted teams like City and PSG are ultimately aspiring to now that they've conquered their own yards. And City's looking good this season with players like Aguero, Sterling, and Bernardo Silva all putting up some of the best performances of their lives, maybe, and they're doing it without the likes of Kevin De Bruyne this season, who was ever present and so crucial to their success a year ago. Don't get me wrong, Kevin De Bruyne has been playing lately, but he's mostly been, and even when he plays, he's not having as much of an effect as he did last season. Similarly, David Silva isn't putting in the performances that City fans are used to. Fernandinho is having a hard time in Europe at times, but they're still putting in performances that are worthy of considering them as one of the top 3 teams in Europe, in my opinion. My one worry for them is that they haven't been massively challenged in the Champions League so far, but you can only beat the teams in front of you. And the next team in front of them is probably their biggest challenge as of yet. Or are they? Because Tottenham in this moment are in an awful patch of form. Dele and Kane have both returned, so that notion doesn't work as an excuse for their run of six matches now that has seen them win once, draw once, and lose four. Nor are they missing anyone else of note, really, unless you consider Eric Dier someone of note. I don't really rate him. Right now, this feels like one of the worst patches in Pochettino's Tottenham career, as suddenly they're in danger of missing out on the top four. These guys were title contenders at one point. They were in the mix. And this is when you also consider that in March, there was a two-match stretch that saw Spurs get bounced from the FA Cup and the League Cup. It's not been a good month for them, sorry. But in Europe, they've looked strong, and conversely, from City, have had to face strong opposition. In the group stage, they took on Barcelona, Inter, and current Eredivisie leaders PSV. Then they blanked Borussia Dortmund with a 4-0 aggregate score, going away to Signal Iduna Park and handing Dortmund their only defeat in regulation time for this entire season at home. Of course, Dortmund's other defeat at home was in a shootout. So, Tottenham's European form flies in the face of their current domestic form a little bit, while City, well, quite simply, are one of the best sides in Europe right now, on paper, but haven't faced the best sides of Europe in this competition. Despite that, I can't see an upset in this one, and I think that City will win it 5-3, a massive performance from Kane in the tie, but not enough to see Spurs through. A rematch is on our hands here, a rematch from last season where Liverpool had all but finished off FC Porto in the round of 16 after just 53 minutes of football. It was 5-0 on that occasion, and Liverpool rotated their squad heavily in the second leg, as did Porto, to be fair, in a match that was a complete formality and may have set records for one of the least interesting round of 16 second legs out there. Despite this, and the fact that Porto has been identified by most as the team they wanted, Klopp claims that Porto were, quote, not on my wish list. So, Porto were in one of, or arguably the weakest group in the Champions League. I mean, if a side like Schalke can make it out, then the quality just isn't there. And I know Portistas are gonna say, ooh, salty Benfica fan, as they say to literally anything I say about their team. But nah, man, it's just a fact. You guys gotta admit that. Maybe our group was weak too, in hindsight. Considering how poor Bayern Munich has been this season, Ajax was terrible, and we were awful when we had Rui Vitória, but he's gone now. We're a different team, okay? In the round of 16, they took on Roma, a team that's floundering domestically and is at risk of missing out on Champions League football for next season. Hell, they're even at risk of missing out on Europa League qualification. But they put in a good enough performance to take Porto all the way to extra time, where a penalty separated the two teams for Porto to go through. Porto's defense has been decent this year. I actually thought it was better before Pep arrived and forced Militão to right back, but that's just me. In the attack, they're really missing Aboubakar, as he, in tandem with Musa Marega, would be a massive headache for any team. But right now, they'll have to rely on Marega and Tiquinho. Marega, by the way, is having an incredible Champions League campaign, with 6 goals from 7 matches and 2 assists to boot. Liverpool, on the other hand, were in arguably the toughest Champions League group you could ask for, contending with PSG and Napoli for one of the top 2 spots. They just made it through by the skin of their teeth, all down to their home form, because their away form was a massive worry, losing every single one of their group stage matches played away from Anfield. But they snapped that streak when they took on Bayern Munich in the round of 16 and dealt with them pretty easily in the decisive second leg with a 3-1 victory. That victory was partially due to Bayern not being the powerhouse that they once were, but credit has to be given to Liverpool for that performance. It's never easy going to a place like the Allianz Arena and getting a result like that. Salah is having a mediocre season in comparison to his last. In fact, his 20 goals at this point of the season pale in comparison to the 35 he'd scored at the exact same time last season. Even worse, he scored just once and provided 1 assist in his last 10 appearances. He's clearly forcing things out there and it's gotten to his head, but with the form that Mane is in and with Firmino getting better and better as well, you get that feeling that Salah isn't far off from getting back into form, and perhaps these matches against Porto could be the turning point for him. So, Porto are winless in their last 18 visits to England, and I don't think that will change anytime soon. Maybe they could hold Liverpool to a draw at the Dragão, but I can't see it. I think it will be a closer tie than that of last year's, but with Liverpool's improved defense, can't see Porto getting close to a upset, really. I mean, 5-1 Liverpool, I'll throw a goal your way, Porto. Don't say I never did anything for you, the Portistas out there, okay? And here we are. For me, the toughest one to call. I mean, The easy answer is that Juve will come out on top, no problem, because they have the stronger squad with more established players in it. Players that have been to multiple Champions League finals, and some dude named Cristiano who has swiped right on this competition. He's pretty fond of it. But then, I've been following Ajax pretty closely through this competition, and they look legit. In fact, they've had less losses than Juve in this competition, as they went unbeaten in the group stage and lost 2-1 to Real Madrid at home before smashing them at the Bernabeu. And it could have been at least 5, maybe even 6, with Ziyech missing a golden opportunity, and there was some others in there as well. And yes, I know that they had an easier group than Juventus, but was it? Valencia wasn't that great at that time. Young boys, not good. Man United, not the greatest. Okay, yeah, they definitely had an easier group. But the way that Ajax played against Real in that second leg, with absolutely no fear, lightning quick transitional play, and great finishing to boot, besides Ziyech, of course, but Dusan Tadic has been a revelation for them, as a striker as well. 20 goals and 8 assists in the Eredivisie, and 6 goals and 3 assists in the Champions League. They consistently tore Real Madrid's defense apart, seemingly at will, while looking strong defensively with Onana making some key saves. Domestically, it's much of the same, with them recently beating PSV with just 10 men for most of the second half, and have cut the deficit down to just 2 points now with 7 matches to go. Juventus, on the other hand, have had a bit of a checkered season in the Champions League. Domestically, they're fine, at least as far as the Scudetto search goes, as they have a massive 15-point lead there. Though they were dumped from the Coppa Italia with an embarrassing 3-0 loss to Atalanta, and yes, that was with their preferred starting 11 at the time. In the Champions League, they suffered defeats to Manchester United and Young Boys, embarrassingly to Young Boys, and then looked quite feeble in their first leg away to Atletico. Of course, they turned things around in the second leg, which was very impressive, with Ronaldo getting a hat-trick to dismantle Atletico, but as you'll remember, Oblak was millimeters away from saving Juve's second goal, and who knows how the rest of the match would have played out at that point. It still felt like Juventus would have gone on to win it though. Just with the momentum they were carrying. Also, let's keep in mind that it will be touch and go as to whether Ronaldo will be playing in the first leg after he went out with a thigh muscle injury for Portugal. Allegri spoke recently saying that he, quote, hopes to have him ready for Ajax, but it will be difficult, end quote. By the way, he meant the first leg. I don't think he meant Ajax in general, just the first leg. But besides that, Allegri got everything 100% right in the second leg against Atletico and showed why he deserves his reputation as a top tactician when he's on his game. However, I have a hard time trusting Juventus this season. Again, a top side with players with pedigree, but the midfield can be a weak spot at times. Chiellini and Bonucci have made mistakes you wouldn't expect of them this season, and Mandzukic and Dybala, when he's on the pitch, in regards to Dybala, are liable to go completely missing in the attack. Just recently, they lost 2-0 to 13th place Genoa, this after defeating Atletico 3-0. They've had issues at times this season with getting it up, so to speak, and I just wonder if that will happen once again, and if Ajax will be able to take advantage of a first leg with potentially no Cristiano. If the mass amounts of pressure that Juve is putting on themselves to win this thing will cause them to crack, if Ajax grab a couple of goals early in the second leg, I don't know. That could be a scenario that we're facing. Last time, talking about Ajax, I could feel that Ajax was going to cause a big problem for Real Madrid, and I didn't listen to my gut. So this time, with the form that Ajax is in, after they navigated Bayern Munich in the group stage and then dispatched of Real Madrid in the round of 16, I'm getting a vibe, and I'm going to listen to it this time. Ajax to make it through on away goals, 3-3. I could be very wrong with this one. If Juve play as they did against Atletico, then Ajax will get battered, but that match was an exception. It has by no means been the rule for them this season, or at least since December. It's a tough one. Ajax wants revenge for the 1996 final, and I think they'll get it, but just barely. So, guys, who do you have going through? I have Barcelona versus Liverpool in one semifinal, and City versus Ajax in the other one. Make sure you comment below with your picks, because I always love seeing what you guys think will happen. Regardless, thank you for spending your valuable time watching this video. I'm Adrian, and enjoy the quarters. Take care.